My name is Pavel, and I do not mind me being interrupted, so please raise your hands if you have something to say. I'm working at Facebook, have been contributing to iUni for a long enough time, and today I want to talk a little bit about our work in progress work and bringing BPF to have fully internal control of IO using iUni. So, I believe there was enough of different articles and talks about iUni, so I will just briefly outline the idea, and that's it. iUni is a communication channel and new API which brings serves as a communication channel between the user space and the kernel space. There are two sides, so it's a mission queue and completion queue. The user space, or just users, first fill one or more entries into the submission queue, where each entry represents some operation like read or write. Previously, with synchronous operation, so they with synchronous syscalls, it would be like just a normal syscall. Now it is entries in the submission queue one. Then when it's ready, it does a system call to actually submit all the IO to the kernel, and then kernel do all the job on submitting request. When a request completes, it posts an event into the completion queue where the user space can grab them from, and there is all the needed different API like waiting on completion queue and so on. There's also a skipall mode, which I have to mention. It's where you have a kernel thread which actively pulls the submission queue, and so in this mode, the user space usually doesn't even need to do any syscall. The kernel thread will just find it and submit on behalf of the user space. Yep, we've got a lot of different request types, from basic read and write from the beginning to a bunch of different network operations, polling, splicing, brand new, just recently merged file system operation, and the list still grows. And we also got a lot of different features, already mentioned sqpoll. Oops. Okay. Already mentioned sqpoll, IO poll for QLS, IO, different register resources. We can register files and buffers, cut some overhead on different ref counting, like file ref counting, or different internal accounting allocation, and so on. We've got a notion of links, which allows to just link a couple of requests together so they're executed in order, and by default there is no ordering in iUni for the submitted operations. There is different optimization for execution flow, like internal polling and so on and so forth. And I want to give a little bit of an idea how we execute our requests. Okay, it looks like the slides are a bit outdated, and so I uploaded them like 2 hours ago. Anyway, so how do we execute our requests? We usually first try to execute them in some no-wait mode. And so they can just complete because there is already data for whatever reason it is, or can go async with, as it would be the case with, for example, direct block IO. If it doesn't work, we will try our best to find some asynchronous mean to execute the request. For example, for buffer trees that miss the cache, we can wait on a page, or for pullable files like sockets, we can try to execute polling internally and try again when the poll fires. So it's kind of hidden inside iUni epoll looping, but a bit different. But if nothing else works, we would fall back to a thread pool. It is usually slower than any other synchronous mean, but often necessary. But for all hot paths, we try our best to avoid it. So, and because from time to time we see some people having some strange ideas and being absolutely sure in them, I was thinking it would be nice to leave the slide for the reference. The first misconception is quite popular, I would say, for some reason. I have to say it out loud, IUUring is not just a worker pool. As I said before, worker thread is a slower path, and we wouldn't have got such a performance with just worker pool. The second one is that IUUring is not IO completion ports. Not going to elaborate on that, but just to think about a funny fact that Microsoft now tries to bring an IUUring for Windows. Definitely will be interesting to see where it goes. And at last, it's not only about syscall elimination, reducing the number of syscalls. The greatest benefit is the API itself, providing uniform way of asynchronous IO, and also providing so many optimizations that haven't been available before. Okay, going back to the main topic. A problem is that the hardware vulnerabilities hit us hard, and all the mitigation made syscalls pretty expensive. And even though we have some syscall batching in IUUring, it still takes some time for doing syscalls. And to give an idea, if you have some tight loop with syscalls inside doing not much work. For example, for this one, I've been doing like 4 kilobyte copy. The syscall overhead was taking for me more than 50% of CPU time. But for more or less newer and better CPU, I would expect it to be like maybe 20-ish, 30-ish percent, something. Still a lot. And for the next case, I was using a standard IUUring benchmark. In this instance, it was doing no op operations, but with batching 32, and that means that we have just one syscall per every 32 operations. And it was taking like a quarter of CPU. And with something more realistic, like IO against a block device, null block device in this case, with some somewhat more realistic batching with 4 requests at a time, it was more than 15% for me, which is still a lot. And this test was just doing like 1.6 million IOPS per second. And if you have been following Jens's updates on IUUring, he gets like 3.5 and more million IOPS per core with a single open drive. So it's not so unrealistic case. I mentioned sqpool before, and one may ask why not use sqpool to just eliminate all the syscalls. But it's not really the ultimate solution because we have some problems with sqpool. The first one, it requires a separate core, otherwise it is kind of useless probably. And it gets a lot of, takes a lot of CPU cycles. You can get cache bouncing, and you still need the user space to process your SQS, and it would probably need to wait for completion. So it's kind of depends on your workload, but it may be still be a syscall for waiting. And so following the whole idea of throwing BPF at every problem we have, let's try out BPF here as well. Okay, there are some requirements we put up. The first one would be flexibility, because basically the users should be able to program anything they wish with it, and if there are too much restrictions, it would be just useless piece of junk, yet another one. So the first one, BPF should be able to submit new requests, that's obvious one. And as it submits new requests, we should also be able to access the results of them, having some kind of feedback. More to that, we may want to access multiple completions at single BPF run. Another criteria would be to be able to analyze and access normal user space memory. Of course, there are always some BPF's way of doing it, like might be using BPF maps, BPF arrays, but it can be a problem for adoption, especially if the application have never used BPF before. And the other criteria would be it should be of low overhead, otherwise the user can just go to the user space and that's it. So the first idea of using it, a dump idea, is to add a callback for each SQE and run it for each request and run it on completion. And fairly enough, it could be of benefit for some cases, but I see just more problems to it. First of all, it adds some overhead in the generic non-BPF path. Not only that, but what also prevents some further optimizations, and that's a big no. And also, we should be able to finally control the context from which we executed, because it shouldn't be run from RQ. We may need to avoid recursion and all the stuff. And this code just looks horrible. Yeah. The way it's solved is just creating a new ionic type of requests, BPF request, which basically solves all the problem I mentioned and nicely give us a way to use all the ionic internal infrastructure, all the batching, all the optimizations inside. There are also a bunch of nice wins, like being able to wait and so on. The only downside to it is that it may require, it's not free. It adds some overhead, but we can work with it and more about it a bit later. The next problem was to get completion into BPF program. So we could have used linking, the first idea that came to mind, but it has never been considered seriously, because it is by design pretty limited. So the idea is that we can use links and we can pass SQ of the previous request to our BPF program. But as I said, first it by design binds it to linking, which is already pretty restrictive, and also there will be a problem to passing multiple SQs, and that's a bummer. The way we we did go is by creating multiple completion queues, and each request just specified submission times to which completion queues the completion should go, and obviously BPF will be able to get events from completion from any completion queue, post new events, and so on. It also gave us one nice way of new synchronization, like posting to another completion queue. And for example, what I had in mind of using it, for example, you have some bunch of work and let's say a piece of work, and you create a BPF request, you allocate a completion queue, give this completion queue in use to this BPF request. So the only one using this completion queue is that BPF request. You run this BPF, it keeps itself alive, working on the problem. And when it's done, if ever, it just posts a new completion or using any other way of notification to the user space that it's done with the work. The last one was about accessing the user space memory, and it is actually already solved by BPF. They introduced not so long ago sleepable BPF programs, and that solved a lot of problems, and that's a big deal for using BPF as well, because submission may want to wait. So it's quite a hard requirement for us. So about Zavrhead, some may want to, the first thing, some may want to use a lot of BPF requests, and it costs some time because some may link additional BPF requests per each normal BPF request, basically doubling the number of requests. As you may guess, it would cost you something. And the other problem is that we usually were optimizing it for batched submissions because there is a system call constant overhead. So submitting just by one request doesn't make too much sense for Ayuri from the performance perspective. But good news, we did a lot of work on that front past year. We cut a lot of just overhead number of instructions for submitting requests. We amortized the some parts of per submission overhead. So for BPF, it is pretty much free. We did a lot of different optimizations like request caching and other kind of batching, completion batching, all the stuff. So it's not really too much of overhead for creating an empty request, especially comparing to overhead we have down the step, for example, for doing actual I/O. So a little bit about the API. First of all, you create your BPF programs. It's not as interesting here, it's BPF specific. Then you register your BPF request in IO Ring. You can unregister them as well. There was proposal to have not registered BPF requests, so it may see the light at some point. This slide would be just an optional optimization. Next, to submit a BPF request, you as usually just fill in an ASCII entry, submission queue entry. You specify the opcode to be BPF, and you set the program index which was registered before NSS it. From the BPF point of view, first of all, just a reminder that BPF programs take a context argument, which you see as the struct in the middle of the slide. And a BPF request usually can return some return code. So if it specifies return zero, it just instructs the user to complete the request, the BPF request. If it returns wait, prior to that, it should fill into entries in BPF context to specify for which completion queue it should wait and for how much request it should wait for. This also user data in BPF context. It's basically the user data you specified when you submitted the BPF requests. And if it just treated, provide some additional way to provide some context to BPF programs. And at the bottom, there are basic BPF helpers to submit new requests, emit and grab CQS from completion queues. Pretty basic and all as I described before. Here is a libbpf example with maybe useless, but showing all the API which I described before, getting new events, submitting new requests, reading user space memory, waiting for completion queue. And there are some further ideas what we may have, what we may want, and it may see the light at some point, depends on where it goes. But if you have some ideas, it would be welcome. We would love to hear it. So going to the numbers. There was a group of German researchers who were willing to try out the project. And so big kudos to them. They proposed one test case, which I've been describing here. It is a big file copy with buffer trees, and the file is fully cached. So maybe nothing interesting, but it kind of gives an idea about overheads and what we can get. As you see, if you take a look at the first table, you can compare the first line and the third one. With mitigation enabled on one setup, we've got like 40% win for BPF or something like that. But when we disable mitigations, during BPF pretty much loses to the synchronous version, which is pretty much expected. And that's great to get such a performance win with mitigations enabled. But it highly depends on the CPU, so we tried out another one, and for another CPU, the difference is not as great as it was for the first tests. So you can see in the second table that the difference is not as big as before. So it will be highly dependent on mitigations you enable and on the actual CPU you use. It might be not so interesting examples, but that's the one I put here. And other cases are still in development, because each of them requires some optimization and some thinking of it. So it's left for further updates. Excuse me. There is some parts missing in the slides, so we'll just talk through it. I have to note that I do not expect it to be pretty much useful for applications which naturally have a good batching rates and do not care much about latency, but it's not always the case. Because first of all, batching usually hurts latency, and the other one is that it's not always possible. For example, with sockets, TCP sockets, you would need to serialize it somehow at the end because of ordering concerns. Excuse me, give me a second. Yep, there's a lot of different ideas. I would love to try it out for caching system databases, for broadcasting collect. Some people mentioned before Quick, using that it can benefit by using it in Quick protocol. And there is some move on those fronts. Did I lose that?
Just trying to switch you over to the latest version of your slides.
Oh. Okay. Can I get to the previous one? Perfect.
Is that the one?
Yeah. So there are some cases we would love to try more realistic one that would benefit in the real world, but and there are some motion on that front, but it is not quite still there. It would be also interesting to see if it would be of use to fuse file system. But if you have some more ideas, again, we would just love to hear them. Next steps would be to explore new test cases and do optimizations, and each new test case usually brings some ways just to optimize a thing. And it works to do it because it usually benefits normal IO ring, non-PPF IO ring as well. So it's a good exercise for us. And there are some backlog left, some stuff on BPF side and some slight regressions because of multi-CQ, which I need to solve first. And that's it. There is some resources if you would love to go through the BPF stuff with libUring and examples and just our IUUring mailing list guides and manuals.
That's great. Thank you, Pavel. So does anybody have questions? Raise your hand or turn your microphone on and or just speak up or ask in the chat and we can relay.